being regularly published, stands testimony to his proficiency in the field. The guidelines of this BRS Teaching Award, the presenters have been chosen from a list of 10, and the shortlisted 3 will do their oral presentation today. They have already been assessed for a tally of 60 by internal judges, and now they will be assessed for a score of 40 by 3 eminent judges. The oral presentation will be there for 8 minutes and 2 minutes will be allowed for the discussion. Questions will be only from the judges and the questions will be answered only by the presenter. To judge this award, we have 3 eminent judges, Professor Dr. Mahadevan sir, our orator for the day, he needs no introduction and was the former dean of Jipmer Pondicherry. Our next judge, Professor Dr. Gunasinghe sir, former dean of Kanyakumari Medical College and former professor of pediatrics at Madras Medical College. And my teacher, Professor P. Ramachandran sir, dean of academics at Sri Ramachandra Medical College and Research Institute and former director at the Institute of Child Health and Hospital for Children, Egmore. Sonita sir. Dean of Faculty, Shrihar. The first presenter for this B.R. Santhanakrishnan Teaching Institute Award will be Dr. Nivedita from the Institute of Child Health, Chennai, on COVID-19 antibody status and its impact on the severity of dengue illness among children. This is an observation study from a tertiary care center in South India.
Next slide.
You will be now assessed for a score of 40 for the relevance of the study, the methods employed, statistical analysis, validity of the conclusion, time taken for the presentation and presentation per se, slides, discussion and answer to the queries. Over to the presenter.
A very good morning to everybody present here. I'm Dr. Nivedita from Institute of Child Health Hospital, Chennai. And I'm here to present my paper today on COVID-19 antibody status and its impact on the severity of dengue illness. And at this point, I would like to thank my mentors, Professor Lakshmi ma'am and Professor Purvaidi ma'am for guiding in this study. We are at a unique point of time where there are two coexistent viral infections that are rampant right now. One is the dengue illness, which has been endemic with us for quite some time, and the other is the recent pandemic, SARS-CoV-2. Both of these are single-stranded RNA viruses and they have structural similarities and similarities in clinical presentations also. The initial observation which was made during the initial stages of the pandemic showed that the severity of COVID was less in areas which were already endemic to dengue. Further, there were also many reports which stated how in COVID-infected patients there were false positive dengue serology reports noted. Further, molecular studies were done which showed how the dengue virus antibodies cross-reacted with the spike protein of the SARS-CoV-2. So based on these information, it will be interesting to note that there might be a possible cross-reactivity among these two viruses. And how does the dynamic between these two viruses play out? Could it be a cross-protection or would it increase the severity of illness through the already well-known antibody-dependent enhancement mechanism? And hence, with these objectives in mind, this study was undertaken with the primary objective to measure the IgG levels of COVID antibody among all children who are admitted with dengue illness, and further to study the profile of the dengue illness among those children with positive and negative antibodies. Ours was an analytical cross-sectional study which was done for a period of 6 weeks in ICH, Chennai. Consecutive sampling was done, and all children between the age group of 1 month to 12 years with the diagnosis of dengue according to the WHO 2009 definition were included in our study. Children who had co-infections with other tropical infections such as enteric, malaria and scrub were excluded. Children with pre-existing immunodeficiency and already in, under immunosuppressive therapy were excluded from our study. And after careful inclusion and exclusion criteria, study parameters such as clinical features, disease severity according to the WHO criteria, laboratory investigations and complications were followed in all children until death or discharge. Serum levels of IgG COVID antibodies were measured, and levels more than 10 international units were considered reactive. Children were then divided into antibody positive and negative groups, and comparison in the clinical study parameters were done between the two groups. Statistical analysis was done using EpiInfo 7 software, and a p-value of less than 0.05 was considered statistically significant. Coming to the results of our study included a total of 50 children with a mean age of 6.67 years, and we had a predominant population of girls. And in our study, 36% were reactive for COVID antibody and 64% were negative antibody status. Coming to the profile of the dengue illness, our study included a predominant of children with dengue with warning signs, that is 64%, 22% of children had severe dengue, while 14% had dengue without warning signs. This is the comparison of the clinical features among the two groups. From this table, it could be seen that the features of rash, petechiae and seizures were not observed in the children who had COVID antibody. And points which are highlighted, it was seen with statistical significance that rash, petechiae and periorbital puffiness was associated with COVID antibody negative status. And this is a comparison of the complications. From this table, it could be seen that the major complications such as shock, need for inotropes, encephalopathy, and acute kidney injury did not occur in children who were positive for COVID antibodies. It is also seen with statistical significance that in simple dengue fever without warning signs, of the 7 children, 5 were antibody positive, and in severe dengue, of the 11 children, 10 children were antibody negative. And hence, according to the statistical significance derived from our study, it could be said that children who had mild dengue were antibody positive with a p-value of 0.03, while children who had severe dengue were antibody negative with a p-value of 0.04. And hence, among the 11 severe dengue children, 10 of the children did not have COVID antibody. And the only death which occurred in our study population was a refractory hypotensive shock, and that child was also antibody negative. And this is a comparison of the laboratory parameters among the two groups, and this laboratory parameters did not significantly vary among the two groups. Coming to the discussion of our study, this is a comparison of our study with the study done by N. Ravikumar et al. The common point which was observed in both of our studies was that 1/3 of the children who participated in the study were COVID antibody reactive, similar to their findings. Our study included a greater proportion of children with dengue with warning signs, while their study had a greater proportion of children with severe dengue. There was no shock and antibody positive in our study, whereas in their study they were did not find statistical significance among shock between both the groups. However, statistical significance could not be derived in other clinical parameters. Hence, with the evidence at hand, it can be stated that previous exposure to COVID may be protective against severe dengue. And the scientific reason behind this could be the effect of neutralizing antibodies cross-reacting between the two viruses, and the probable antigen could be the nucleocapsid protein of dengue virus. Limitations, we could not derive statistical significance in certain clinical parameters due to limited sample size. And if such similar studies and results are reproducible in large-scale studies, it could highlight another advantage of COVID immunization and previous COVID exposure. Hence, I would like to conclude by saying that dengue is milder in children already exposed to COVID, and there is increased severity in COVID antibody-naive children. Though there are many studies about the risk factors for severe dengue, our study suggests a probable protective factor against severe dengue. and these are my references.
So do you mean to say better to get COVID and get protection from severe dengue?
Oh.
That's why we are without mask, maybe we are protected.
Not necessarily infected, sir. Even immunized, it could be a...
Immunization also may protect against dengue, isn't it? So do you think how long is the protection, maybe hypothetical?
Sir, as long as there are IgG, detectable IgG antibodies.
No, that's what I am asking. How long, suppose I get a COVID vaccination, okay, you say it may protect against severe dengue, how long? See, they say every year, now they say third dose, I don't know.
So there are different studies, but there is no definable cutoff, but generally around 6 months, but that is variable, sir.
The only one study in, there are a lot of studies on the, I don't know, the, you showed one Ravi Kumar et al.
So this study was also comparing the severity of dengue illness with the antibody status, sir. But how long the antibody status, we retain the antibody status after an infection or immunization, I have not included those studies, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you for
thank
a very thank you for a very a fine interesting and of course a novel way of thinking which has been ethical, of course a retrospective and a relevant study. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
May you please go to your first slide, please. Well, there is one word for which I require how you understand about. Because next one.
Previous slide. Red plan.
Next slide.
Previous slide.
Next one. One table was molecular docking studies. What do you understand by molecular docking study?
Sir, here antibodies were done and the epitopes of coronavirus antibodies were synthetically made and interaction studies were done where they saw whether those dengue antibodies interacted with the antigens of coronavirus, sir. So the interaction was studied, sir, in these studies, sir.
I think now you were, one of the conclusions which you made was about the immunization and what is called the vaccine-induced antibodies. Am I right?
Yes.
Right. What is the difference between vaccine-induced antibodies and natural exposure antibodies, which can also occur in this condition?
Sir, here we compared against which antigen the antibodies were there, sir. So it was similar, sir. There we saw antibodies following infection and immunization, antibodies against non-structural and antibodies against structural and membranous antigens, sir. So thank that was the observation here, sir.
Thank you.
Time is up. Okay. How was the sample size chosen?
Sir, actually our pilot study, they did it with a sample size of 44, sir. Based on that sample size, our actual calculated sample size was 190, sir. We did it with a total sample size of 190, but due to logistic and technical issues, we were able to get antibody reports only for 50, sir. So these results are based for those 50. The rest of the 150 samples are under processing. Due to floods, there are issues with the kit. So we were not able to get the reports for the rest, sir. So the study is only stating the reports of the 50 samples which we received, sir. Okay. The 50 reports we received, sir.
So we'll be happy if something good comes out of COVID, like a protection in dengue.
Probably.
So that's a good news. The other thing which is a big concern is your zero positivity is only 35%.
Yes, sir.
Which is not like what we see reported in the fourth ICMR zero survey, which is nearly 70%. Do you think is there any specific reason for that?
So this study is done in the pediatric population, sir. So we don't have the confirmed
for pediatric population only. The 70% is only pediatric. I'm not talking about general.
Yes,
okay,
sir.
Right. The third is, did you study any other factor like age, obesity, other things, or you just looked at the antibody? Whether they were all contributing, because in your group of this COVID positive and COVID negative, there might have been various other confounders which might be contributing to the severity. Did you study any of them?
Age was studied between both groups, sir. There was no statistical significance different age, sir.
Okay.
And other confounding factors, we mainly considered co-infections, sir. Since other tropical co-infections are associated with more risk, so that was our exclusion criteria, sir. So we included all the other co-infections, and primarily only dengue infections were included in the study, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Nivedita. The next presenter is Dr. Nimisha from Kaveri Hospital, Trichy, on the significance of waist to height ratio as an early predictor in developing metabolic syndrome in children of age group 5 to 12 years in a tertiary care center.
Respected judges, senior pediatricians, my colleagues and friends, a very good morning to all. I really thank my mentors, Dr. Senkutuvan and Dr. Suresh, for supporting for this project. The title of my study is Significance of Waist-Weight Ratio as an Early Predictor in Developing Metabolic Syndrome in Children of Age Group 5 to 12 Years in a Tertiary Care Center in Trichy. Going through introduction, review of literature, aims, materials and methods, results, discussion and conclusion. Prevalence of obesity has increased worldwide over the last few decades, especially in developing countries. And studies have shown that obese toddlers have an odds ratio 1.3 and obese teenagers have odds ratio 17.5 for becoming obese adults. And it is also seen that childhood obesity is an early risk factor for adulthood mortality and morbidity. Seeing children like this is not uncommon these days, hence the significance of this topic. So what is metabolic syndrome? Metabolic syndrome is defined as the presence of any three or more of the following according to their age-related values. The criteria are elevated fasting blood sugar, high systolic or diastolic blood pressure, elevated fasting triglyceride, low HDL, abdominal adiposity which is measured by the waist circumference more than 90th centile for their age. In our study, we aim to determine the ability of waist-weight ratio in identifying children with metabolic syndrome, and our objectives were to identify the cutoff value of waist-weight ratio above which the intervention and close follow-up may be considered, and to compare the association of metabolic syndrome with BMI and waist-weight ratio. Our study was a cross-section study done in a private tertiary care center in Trichy for a total duration of 2 years with a sample size of 170. And we included all the overweight and obese children according to the current IAP definition from the age group 5 years to 12 years. And we excluded children with syndromes and also children with endocrine abnormalities and those including long-term steroids. We measured weight, height, BMI, waist circumference, BP of children of this age group. And we identified the children who fall in overweight and obese category. Then we proceeded with fasting blood sugar, fasting lipid profile and thyroid function test. We already excluded previously diagnosed hypothyroid children, and at this step we excluded the newly detected one also. So total of 188 children met the inclusion criteria, and 12 children's parents were not willing for further blood investigations, and 4 children were hypothyroid and 2 were syndromic. So totally 170, comprising 92 boys and 78 girls, were recruited for the study. This is the age distribution of my study. Majority of the children were between 8 to 10 years of age group, followed by 5 to 7 years. So in our study, it showed 72.4% children were obese as per current definition, and 27.6% children were overweight. Then all the variables, namely fasting blood sugar, HDL, waist circumference, BP, triglycerides, were compared in obese and overweight children. And children were again classified into two groups, waist weight ratio less than 95th and more than 95th centile for comparison. So in out of 170 children studied, we got 70 children who satisfied the criteria for metabolic syndrome. This chart showing association of BMI and metabolic syndrome. In this we can see 45% of obese and 30% of overweight children had metabolic syndrome. In other words, BMI classification identified 30% children as non-obese but already had features of metabolic syndrome. In this chart, we can see the association of weight-height ratio centile and metabolic syndrome. And it was found that much was found in 46% of those children who had high waist-weight ratio, as against only 5% in those whose ratio was less than 95th centile. So, if the child has waist-weight ratio more than 95th centile for their age, there is significantly higher chance for metabolic syndrome. An ROC curve was plotted using the data from 170 children. The area under the curve was near to 0.7, and we derived at a cutoff point 0.58 with 62% sensitivity and specificity. In this table, we compared all the parameters like sensitivity, specificity, positive and negative predictive value, and diagnostic accuracy of both BMI and waist weight ratio centile, and we got higher specificity and positive predictive value in case of waist weight ratio centile, even though the diagnostic accuracy was comparable to that of BMI. For a common issues like obesity, the test should be more specific. So, out of 70 children with metabolic syndrome, 69 had waist weight ratio centile more than 95th centile for their age, but only 56 children with metabolic syndrome had BMI more than 27th adult equivalent, and waist weight ratio more than 95th centile had 95% specificity and 98.6% positive predictive value, and the diagnostic accuracy of this ratio was comparable to that of BMI. In conclusion, metabolic syndrome in children is rising at an alarming state in developing countries, especially in this post-COVID era. And as there is no clear-cut definition, unlike the adult population, it is often underdiagnosed and missed in our real practice. So waist-weight ratio is an easy parameter for identifying children with cardiometabolic risk factors at an early age. And our study recommends a waist-weight ratio of 0.58 in children less than 12 years as action point. A study with larger population will give you more better result. And also, our study has shown that BMI classification, when used alone, misses every fifth children with metabolic syndrome. So, waist-weight ratio is a simple and effective parameter for identifying metabolic syndrome. This can be done even in a crowded OP or in a school setting by teachers using just a means tape. Thank you.
Hello. Yeah. Congratulations, ma'am, for your excellent presentation.
Thank you, sir.
How do you measure the waist circumference?
It is measured at the midplane between lower rib and higher point of iliac crest. It comes around the
umbilicus. Close on or remove the clothes?
Without clothes, sir, at expiration.
Can you just, adolescent girl, you remove clothes? You say it is possible in a crowded OP. Is it possible? You remove the clothes and it is a very sensitive part, I believe. You say it is very easy, maybe you are okay.
Okay, sir.
Okay, another thing is So what did you do with these children? Just maybe out of your this, because we know it is a alarming trend. What are the use of metabolic syndrome in the term? How much hypertension, how much elevated sugar or elevated triglyceride? Can you say without?
So when I when I looked into the studies, there are no much studies on metabolic syndrome in children. But this issue, when I started my study, I rarely got sample from in the beginning. But post COVID era, I got lots of children with this issue. Many children are obese, and in our setting, the parents think that the more the children eat, that is better for them.
No, no, ma. You said simply metabolic syndrome.
Okay, sir.
How many children had elevated sugar? How many children had hypertension? How many children had triglyceride increase or something like that? Okay. Never analyzed.
In my sample wise, the children who satisfied criteria was around 70, and majority of them had high triglyceride as the common factor, sir. High triglyceride was the parameter which was seen in more than 65 patients, and the lower factor was BP, sir.
Okay, ma'am. Which one do you think better, the weight hip ratio or the weight height, I mean waist height ratio or maybe BMI, which one is better?
I personally think that it is waist height ratio.
Not personal thinking.
Okay. After the study, I think it's waist height ratio, sir.
Waist height ratio is better.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am, for again bringing the topic of malnutrition. This is also a form of malnutrition. So thank you for the study. I don't know whether I missed that slide or not. The slide on the references which you had used, and especially whenever we talk about measurements, we go for certain standards which have been published either nationally, internationally, or in Southeast Asia region. So we have basically one easily downloadable free software called AnthroPlus from WHO. So which is the standard which you had used, and I don't know whether that's a particular slide.
I took the sample, the guideline from International Journal of Obesity, sir, for all the markers.
Maybe if you had included that as a reference, then it becomes easy for us to look at your, what are you referring to, in which standard which you are, because that is one thing which was probably your slide has to get. How do you distinguish between endogenous obesity and exogenous obesity?
In my study,
a general question, because obesity, this is the first question which we always tell our residents, saying that this is the very easy way to distinguish between endogenous obesity and exogenous obesity.
Exogenous obesity comes from our eating practices, nutritional obesity.
No, in relation to the cause, in relation to the etiology, then you can put them into this group, or you let them send them to the next group of experts, endocrine experts. Okay.
It is.
Thank you. It's a good OP-based study. So good thing you took it up, and it's an emerging problem. So that way, it's very good. So I was also about to ask by Dr. Gunasinghe regarding the waist-hip ratio. But when you are talking about privacy issues in most of our OP, probably you are wise in choosing waist and height. Okay. The only problem is height is something which generally most of the pediatricians are not documenting properly. As Dr. Akhila was pointing out yesterday, that may be the only limitation. But as a study purpose, it's very good. I just want to know, what is the purpose of this study? What do you want to know about metabolic syndrome and versus obesity?
So majority of the adult obese.
So what you want to know is, you don't want to miss any case of metabolic syndrome?
No, sir. Majority of the adult issues, like all these cardiovascular issues, can be prevented at an early stage.
So you don't want to miss any child with a metabolic syndrome?
Yes, sir.
So which one do you concentrate on, sensitivity or specificity?
Now it is a common issue, sir. So I go for specificity, sir.
Specificity?
Yes, sir.
You don't want to miss any case, or you are going to be 100% sure that all cases, your parameters are correct?
Sir, if we bring down the cutoff value, sensitivity will be more, but for
so
a
if your idea is screening purpose, probably I think you should go more for concentration on sensitivity rather than specificity. That is my personal opinion.
Okay,
that's the only thing. Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
Dr. Nimisha, the next presenter, Dr. Janapriya. Role of modified TAL score for predicting severity of infants with bronchiolitis admitted to a tertiary care center, an observational study.
Green color, powdered mode. Green one.
Good morning, I'm Dr. Janapriya Sukumar from Mehta Hospitals. I'm here to present our research on the role of modified TAL score for predicting the severity of infants with bronchiolitis. We pondered whether modified TAL score can be used as a validation score for infants with bronchiolitis. Bronchiolitis is a frequent cause of hospitalization in infants. The diagnosis is clinical and the treatment is to ensure oxygenation and hydration. Though several factors have been proposed to predict the risk, it's difficult to uniformly assess the severity of bronchiolitis. This is where scoring systems come into play. Different scoring systems of varying complexity and inter-observer reliability are available. We searched for a score that can be used by any healthcare personnel to decide on the mode of treatment, and we landed with MTAL score. Review of literature showed that MTAL score had high internal validity and reliability across different groups of physicians and nurses. It also had a good correlation between oxygen requirement and length of hospital stay. MTAL score can be used as a primary tool to confirm the severity of hypoxemia, and it was also found to fare better than the other scores. Hence, we used MTAL score in our study, which can be of great acceptance in the ER setting and help determine the need for PICU admission and oxygen requirement. Our aim was to predict the severity and need for oxygen therapy and length of stay using MTAL score. We also sought to identify the risk factors for PICU admission. It was a retrospective study conducted at Mehta Hospitals, which included all infants less than 1 year admitted with bronchiolitis during the period of January 2018 to August 2021. These were our inclusion and exclusion criteria. IEC approval was obtained and study participants were divided into two groups, those who received oxygen therapy and those who didn't. The following parameters like demographic details, vital parameters and details of oxygen therapy were recorded, and MTAL score was applied to both groups on admission. The MTAL score has four components, that is respiratory rate for children less than 6 months and more than 6 months, wheezing or crackles on auscultation, oxygen saturation in room air, and utility of axillary muscle. Score of less than 5 was considered mild, a total score of 6 to 10 was considered as moderate, and more than equal to 11 was considered as severe. The length of stay and duration of oxygen therapy across all severity groups were studied. Factors determining PICU admission and host risk factors were recorded, and these were the cutoffs used for the study. A sample size of 128 for each group was estimated using the previous study by Soldier, Duarte, Martinez et al. And data entry was done using Microsoft Excel, and statistical analysis was done using SPSS software. Chi-square test for categorical variables and student t-test for quantitative variables were used, and correlation was assessed using Pearson correlation coefficient. Odds ratio was arrived to identify the predictors for PICU admission, and logistic regression was used to identify independent risk factors. A p-value of less than or equal to 0.05 was considered statistically significant. We managed to satisfy the sample size of 256, and out of the 128 children in the oxygen therapy group, 90 children received oxygen via simple flow nasal cannula and 38 received oxygen via high flow nasal cannula. MTAL was applied and we identified a majority of infants in the moderate severity group, and out of 256 children, 54 admitted in PICU. Baseline parameters like age, gender were comparable across groups. And on our quest to identify the correlation between MTAL and severity of bronchiolitis, we found that MTAL score was significantly lower in children with ward admission. The score was also understandably higher in children receiving oxygen group, and it was also significantly lower in children who received SFNC compared to HFNC. ROC curve was plotted to identify the cutoff for MTAL score. Area under the cutoff, area under the curve for cutoff of 6 had higher sensitivity and specificity for predicting severity and oxygen requirement. On studying the length of oxygen therapy, we found that the duration was lower in SFNC group than HFNC group in infants with moderate severity group, though it was not statistically significant. On studying the length of hospital stay, children who had moderate severity on oxygen therapy group and those who received HFNC group stayed significantly longer duration than the other group. We identified a weak positive correlation between MTAR score and length of stay and MTAR score and oxygen therapy. We also noted an increment of 7.4% of length of stay per unit rise in MTAR score. Heart rate, respiratory rate and hypoxia were significant on univariate analysis, but on multivariate analysis, only hypoxia was found to be a significant predictor. In emergency rooms and wards, no separate scores are being used for bronchiolitis. The advantage of MTAL lies in the simplicity, and it also can be done by both doctors and nurses, as noted by McCallum et al. In their study. An MTAL cutoff score of more than or equal to 6 predicted the need for oxygen requirement with high sensitivity and specificity, as MTAL uses important clinical predictors identified after logistical regression. Correlation was observed between MTAL and duration of oxygen therapy and length of stay. These findings were reflected in other studies. Though Hasegawa et al. Identified respiratory rate as a predictor for PICU admission, in our study, we observed that hypoxia as a significant predictor for PICU admission and oxygen therapy compared to the other parameters. We could not do inter-rater agreement and comparison with other scores, and even for the same score of moderate severity, only some children receive HFNC while many receive SFNC, maybe because of the paucity of HFNC machines available at our hospital. With a higher MTAL score, the chances for longer duration of oxygen therapy, longer hospital stay and a need for HFNC or over SFNC can be predicted, and a score of 6 and more predicts the need for oxygen therapy better. Repeated scoring with MTAL scoring can help to objectively assess the clinical course in bronchiolitis, increasing score implying the increasing severity of bronchiolitis. Based on our findings, we recommend that MTAL score can be done for all infants from admission to discharge by doctors and nurses alike, and MTAL score can be universally followed across India. This will not only help us to manage infants with mild bronchiolitis in primary care center, it will also help us to reduce the burden in referral centers. Thank you. These are my references.
Congratulations, ma, for your excellent presentation. Just basic question, I don't know, you already mentioned. How did you diagnose bronchiolitis?
So bronchiolitis, the children who, first episode of wheezing in infants who presented with, children in less than 1 year, presented first episode of wheezing, with wheezing or crackles on auscultation, tachypnea. This was based on the definition provided in PH book and textbook of pediatrics.
There could have been some mixing up of cases of asthma or episodic wheeze or...
So that's why we managed to include children who presented with first episode of wheezing, sir, in infants. We only included...
So first episode
children.
Of wheezing, it's only bronchiolitis, isn't it?
In first episode, that usual clinical...
I really do not know, ma, that's why another thing is, see, many times, what happened in a big center, in ICH at least, we blame the other hospital who referred. At last minute they have referred, that's why the child deteriorated. We tell the patient also. So now you say, when suppose you treat the child in a lower center, maybe another primary health center or something like that, and the next day it deteriorates.
Yes, sir. That's why we have recommended that MTAL scoring can be if the score keeps increasing, we know that the severity of bronchitis is also increasing, and we can plan for referral accordingly.
Okay.
And or probably stepping up of therapy from SFNC to HFNC if it's intra-center.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much, ma. I think it is again another good study from your institution. Score. I think we know Keith Edwards score for tuberculosis, and a presentation on this previously a dengue score was
done. Yes, sir.
Now this MTAL,
what is the full expansion, or is it
it's modified TAL score, sir. It was
TAL refers to what?
Dr. Ashen TAL, sir. He is a pediatric pulmonologist from Israel.
Achha,
they
so
had
it
initially
is a name,
yes,
like
yes sir.
MTAL.
Okay. Yes sir.
Thank you. And of course the severity directly correlates with your score, and score gives you a direction whether to keep here or keep it there. And,
yes sir.
Do you think in any other way this study can be improved, because your data is there now? What
yes sir, so in our hospital we couldn't do inter-rater agreement because on admission only one doctor will be assessing the child. So if we probably have two doctors assessing at two different intervals on admission, we can probably do inter-rater agreement, and we can also do inter-rater agreement on serial assessment, sir.
Okay,
with this we can improve the validity of the score.
Right, inter-observer variability,
yes,
and CAPA scoring.
Fine. Yes, sir.
Do you think a prospective study would have been better?
Yes, sir, it would have been better, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Second question is, what is the idea of doing this? We know the child is breathing fast, the child has more Vs. If the child has high or low oxygen, this child requires either oxygen or it will have to go to ICU. What way the score helps? Because frankly,
yes, sir,
most of the people don't use score except in presenting in conferences or publishing papers.
Yes, sir.
Except GCS score, I've hardly seen anywhere the scores are being used.
Yes, sir.
No, I'm frankly, I'm asking you. I'm not trying to this thing.
Yes,
you've done a wonderful job. Just want to know.
Yes, sir. So we receive many children. We receive many children being referred to our hospital for bronchitis. Sir. Probably we can ask the referral hospitals to follow.
No, I am asking you
yes,
from these individual parameters.
Okay,
the
sir.
Score.
Yes, sir.
So have you done, whether you have done an individual parameters, what is the sensitivity specificity, or if you have done as a score, what is the difference?
We have done.
Does it differ much?
Okay, sir. Individual parameter we assess for risk factor for predicting PICU admission alone, sir, but not the individual parameters in the score. We studied those separately and the score separately, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
You mentioned about TAL.
Yes.
What is the difference between TAL score and modified
sir,
TAL score?
In TAL score, instead of saturation, that is SpO2 via pulse oximetry, they had used cyanosis, sir, which was like none or perioral on crying or perioral without crying. So we felt that that could have some subjective differences, whereas SpO2 will have like an objective value which could be better applied in our setting.
That is modified TAL.
Yes, sir. This is
one more parameter.
Yes, sir.
One more is there?
No, no, sir. Instead of cyanosis.
No, no. There is one more parameter in the modified TAL score compared to the original TAL score. Are you aware of it? There is an age group cutoff of the respiratory.
Yes, sir. Less than 6 months.
Less than 6 months and more
yes,
than
sir.
6 months.
Mm.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Yes, sir. Thank Bye. You, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Janapriya, and we thank the judges for judging the Dr. BRS award. I now request Dr. Mohammed Ismail, President IIP Tamil Nadu, Dr. Ramesh Babu, President-elect IIP Tamil Nadu, Dr. Rajendran, Honorary Secretary IIP Tamil Nadu, to hand over the certificates of honor to our esteemed judges.